Hello, everyone. I'm Barbara Ham Lee. If you're one of the 25 million Americans who suffer with asthma, then you know all about the wheezing, tightness in the chest, shortness of breath, and coughing when an attack happens. If you're an African American, you are three times more likely to die from asthma than whites. In fact, black women have the highest death rate of all. So why is asthma so potentially deadly? Can it be cured? And what does money, healthcare, and the environment have to do with developing asthma? We'll share some answers and insights on this edition of Another View on Health, right after this news from NPR.
Discussing today's topics from an African American perspective, this is Another View.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Another View. I'm Barbara Ham Lee. I hope you are enjoying this beautiful weather. Today is the start of a long weekend, Memorial Day weekend, so I hope you have some great plans. Now, if you or someone you know has asthma, you know how scary it is when an attack happens. But did you know that genetics, your social and economic status, access to healthcare, and exposure to environmental triggers can all contribute to your development of asthma? African Americans are three times more likely than whites to be hospitalized because of asthma, three times more likely to die from the disease, and according to the Environmental Protection Agency, 13% of all black children in the U.S. have asthma, compared to 8% of white and Hispanic children and 12% of American Indian and Alaska Native children. The good news is that while there is no cure for asthma, it can be controlled. Joining us to talk about asthma and treatment is Dr. Lauren James, a family medicine practitioner with Bon Secours Portsmouth Medical Associates. Dr. James, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Hello. How are you doing
today? I'm doing great. So glad to have you. And our favorite cardiologist, Dr. Keith Newby with Fort Norfolk Medical Cardiology Associates. Hello, Dr. Newby.
How are you?
I'm doing good.
Good.
I think you have some information you want to share before we get the conversation started today.
First and foremost, I wanted to send a real significant shout out to my beautiful wife, Peggy. This is our 16th wedding anniversary today.
Oh, happy anniversary.
And I am happy, happy, happy. She's kept me straight for 16 years, and she's still with me. So that's a very positive thing. So I wanted to tell her, send her a little shout out, tell her I love her very, very much.
Fabulous.
Second thing is we actually have a health fair tomorrow at First Baptist Butte Street. We're one of the things, yours truly speaking, and one of my colleagues, Dr. Mark Fleming, who's an oncologist. So we're going to be talking, of course, about some heart issues and cancer prevention. And, of course, we're going to have some vendors there, you know, free HIV testing and some other things we're going to be kind of going through. So I wanted to make sure I brought that out. It's actually at the youth campus, which is right directly across from the Murray Center. And we're going to be there from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. So I wanted to make sure I presented that.
And it's free for everybody?
Free for everyone. And I wanted to encourage people to come out. I think it'll be a good event, and we're going to have some good information we're going to bestow. And bring people out if they can.
Okay,
all right.
Fantastic.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Not a problem. So, Dr. James, tell us what happens to the body when someone has an asthma attack. What's going on?
Well, basically, the lungs are reacting to an allergen such as dust, cold air, something like that is causing the lungs to have a almost inflammatory reaction in it. That's what's making it difficult for people to breathe at that time. And it's just seeing that things that can worsen it are exercise and, like we said, pollen, different things in the air.
So you can, allergies and asthma kind of go hand in hand,
they
is that
do,
right?
They do. Sometimes if your allergies are severe enough, you need an inhaler, and sometimes allergies are just what are aggravating your asthma to be uncontrolled at some point.
So for someone who has never experienced an asthma attack, can you kind of describe what the person is going through? I know their lungs are inflamed, but what is happening to them from a physical perspective and an emotional perspective for that matter?
Well, usually it can present with a cough. Some people may report a dry, hacky cough that's new to them. But sometimes acutely it can be a shortness of breath that they just can't really recover from on their own. And a lot of times it can cause anxiety for the patient. It's been seen that people who have asthma, and especially uncontrolled asthma, are less active because they're scared of this response that can be overwhelming at times.
Mm-hmm. So if you're with someone and they have an asthma attack, I remember my daughter has asthma, and I remember the first time she had an attack. It scared me half to death, and she was afraid because she had the wheezing and so forth. What should you do?
You should try to get to the doctor and get an inhaler. Okay. And
the immediate attack while it's happening, is there anything that you need to do for that person, or they just kind of have to ride it out?
Try to calm them down. Because usually, unless it's somebody who's like high risk, like actually being intubated for asthma, they can overcome it themselves eventually. And you have a while until your oxygen gets really low. So you can, maintain with staying calm and trying to take good breaths until you can get to medical care.
Until you can get there. Dr. Newby, is there any connection between heart disease and asthma?
Well, it's not so much necessarily a connection as much as it is the symptoms could be quite similar. We've seen quite a few patients who were diagnosed with asthma or bronchitis, and they've had it for a long period of time. And, we end up finding out it's heart and not necessarily lung. So it can be, the two can be quite similar. You think about if you look up even in angina symptoms, they'll say chest tightness, which a lot of people with asthma will feel tightness in their chest. So they can, heart and lung, and they are really next to each other, and they can have very similar symptoms. So it's a matter of understanding. I tell people all the time, if you have a long-standing problem, if you've had an asthma, kind of flare and you're wheezing, and this is ongoing for weeks, it still could be asthma, but you need to start thinking about what the other possibilities could be, and that could be heart-related. So I always tell people, when you see something out of the ordinary, long-standing problems, things that, you treat them with asthma medication, but they're just not getting better, you need to start really considering there may be something else going on.
440-2665 or 1-800-940-2240 are the numbers to call to join our conversation. What questions do you have for Dr. James and Dr. Newby, particularly surrounding allergies and asthma? 440-2665, 1-800-940-2240. So, Dr. James, is there a difference in asthma between children and adults?
Not that I've seen. I guess the issue with children is that they might not tell you their symptoms. You have to watch and be more observant, whereas an adult can tell you their symptoms. But it can be acutely onset at any age. For example, my mother actually developed asthma recently in the past couple of years, and she's most likely allergic to dust, something in the home, even though we lived there for years. And it is kind of exercise induced, but she never had symptoms until recently, and she's currently well controlled on her inhalers when she takes them.
So it can come on at any time.
Right.
It doesn't. And there's also a correlation in the research I was doing between the one socioeconomic status and asthma as relating to how you're exposed to environmental triggers, things like cockroaches and dust and things
people
of that
can
sort.
Actually be allergic to cockroaches, and that allergy can present as asthma. And other things, if you are low socioeconomic status, you might not have availability to healthcare access or be able to afford your inhalers. They're actually very expensive. Even just a rescue inhaler, which most people are on, is probably like $50 to $65 a month, and that's with insurance. I don't even know how much it is with insurance.
You don't want to know. There's one inhaler that's like $400 with no insurance. It just boggles your imagination to hear the cost of some of these medications. And usually it's the generic inhalers are not as costly, but you'll find that's the one medication by far that I hear the most complaints of with patients as relates to can they afford it. And some of these newer medications, they're great medications, but they cost...
And very, very expensive.
Yeah, very expensive.
So Lisa and I, my producer, we like to joke all the time when if someone has a cold, the African-American community has pneumonia. But what is it about when the stats that I read? I mean, why are Black people 3 times more likely to die or to be hospitalized? And why does it affect children so much more?
I think it's a lot of it's about just access to treatment that was and how long do you put it off before you get treated? And unfortunately, so our community sometimes can put off that treatment till it's too late. And if you kind of keep ignoring it, or you're not, you see it, you know there's an issue there, but you look at your money, you know, your pocketbook, say, well, if I go to the doc, I know I got to, you know, I got to cough up this amount of money, and I really just can't afford to do it. So they'll drag it out, just like I got patients drag out pills. You know, they'll sit there, you get 30 pills, and it costs them, you know, $40. They'll find a way to take the pills every other day, you know, every few days, you know, because they're trying to drag it out so they don't have to, you know, there's a lot of that.
That's a very interesting point. Then if you know a patient is doing that, can you prescribe, I don't know, like a stronger dosage or something that carries over those days, or is that a dangerous practice?
Well, unfortunately, so a lot of that doesn't work that way, because if you look at, you have to look at the drug pharmacokinetics, how the drug actually works. Like, like example, if you have a drug that's twice a day, and patients try to take it once a day thinking that's going to be the same thing, and unfortunately, so it's not, because typically it's twice a day for a reason. You know, the pharmacokinetics don't allow that drug to stay in the system that long. So they go to once a day, it's probably in their system half the day maximum, sometimes even less than that. Half-lives of drugs, you know, you talk about a twice-a-day drug, maybe 8 hours. So that means at 8 hours, half that drug's gone. So you kind of get this, you know, especially you talk about an asthma flare, the issue is if you're not covered, then whatever was triggering that asthma, you know, is going to be there regardless, because a lot of it is, as the good doctor mentioned earlier, is environmental. So if you have an environmental situation, you think about in some of these, depending on the socioeconomic class, if, you know, I get patients all the time tell me about, like, they come and spray bug spray. And that stuff triggers their asthma flares because they use this generic bug spray that they just, and they come in the house and just spray all over the place. That stuff can trigger it, you know. So you talk about all these environmental issues, especially in this particular area, you know, the pollen counts are ridiculous, you know, and the you look at this, the foliage that we have here compared to other places. You go to Arizona. I have a lot of patients say when they fly to Arizona for whatever they fly out there for, they say they have no problems there. But so the time the airplane hits the ground, their asthma flares goes right back. That's got to be environmental.
Dr. James, you want to add to that?
Definitely. I think one of the biggest things is getting people to realize the importance of asthma, that it is severe and people can be intubated and die, just as you said. And I think, especially within our community, I'm from Portsmouth, and I went to Spelman for college and then Morehouse School of Medicine and then EVMS for training, but came back to Portsmouth. And I think one of the biggest things is just patient education. A lot of people think asthma isn't important, but like Dr. Newby said, if your asthma is bad enough, it can mask heart disease almost, because it all plays into one another. And so the biggest thing is patient education. And another thing is that when you're not as active and not as healthy, that affects your money that you're going to make eventually and how you're going to provide for your family. And smoking education, I have multiple patients with asthma that smoke all day and smoke around their children.
And they don't think that that's a trigger, because secondhand smoke is one of the asthma triggers,
isn't it? Right, it's a big trigger. And, you know, they're hurting their kids and they just can't stop. And, you know, these things are expensive to America. We're paying billions of dollars in asthma health care.
Just out of curiosity, Dr. James, what population of your patients would you say have asthma or some breathing? Would you say half or quarter have the ones that you see on the day-to-day basis?
I would say a quarter have asthma, a quarter.
See, that's a big population because, you know, you talk about, you think about most primary care doctors are probably on average seeing between 20 and 30 people a day. So if you think about a quarter, that, you know, you're talking a fair number, you know, and that's every day you're seeing these people. So it's a very prominent diagnosis.
Well, if asthma can happen at any age, for an infant who can't tell you, I can't breathe, you know, what do you look for, or what should trigger you to say, this, something is wrong here and I need to go get help?
Well, usually around one or two, they have different viruses that are called like RSV, and they can present with wheezing. So the biggest thing in like a baby or a young child is difficulty swallowing or breathing and the wheezing, because usually you can hear it pretty good because they're smaller. And just change in behavior. And like we said, also a cough. But usually they don't like to diagnose true asthma until like age two or three, because you don't want somebody so young on inhalers, typically.
So let's talk about treatment, because besides the inhaler, or what is that the first thing that you're given?
Yeah, typically an inhaler for...
And what does the inhaler do?
The inhaler is a steroid that helps decrease the inflammation in the lungs, which is caused by maybe an allergen or things in the air. And usually we start with a short-acting inhaler, such as albuterol or Provencal. And those usually work about, they can last for 4 to 6 hours, the effects. And so most people, especially young kids, will say, oh, I'll use my rescue inhaler prior to activity and PE, things like that. But if people have symptoms more than twice a day or twice during the night or twice during the week, that usually means they're uncontrolled. And then we transition to a daily controller along with the rescue inhaler, because a daily controller should last about 12 to 24 hours. Mm-hmm. And that would be more like a Advair or something like that.
So the daily controller, then, that's designed to keep whatever's triggering your asthma away from making that trigger
and
happen.
Then rescue inhaler is more for like acute events, such as I'm gonna run the mile like I run, but we're all trying to be healthier, right? So, and another thing is during seasons like this with the pollen count, taking antihistamine daily does help reduce some of those side effects, like Singulair, Allegra, Zyrtec, that helps.
440-2665 or 1-800-940-2240. What are your questions for the doctors today? We're talking about asthma, but we do have a family practitioner and a cardiologist here. So if there are other questions that you'd like to ask, we are more than happy to answer them. 440-2665 or 1-800-940-2240. So what's a nebulizer, and how does that work differently than the rescue inhaler?
Nebulizers are mostly for, it's the facial mask, and it blows the air into your nose directly. We use them mostly for younger kids, but studies have been shown that as long as you can take a good breath, you can use a regular handheld inhaler with an MDI component. Mm-hmm. And usually
MDI
around,
meaning?
I knew metered dose inhaler.
Oh, okay.
But it's just almost like a tube. If you use it, some people actually can use a toilet paper roll and connect it to their inhaler.
And do the same thing.
what happens, the reason I have to do that is because the funniest thing is you watch people. There are some people very good at using their inhalers. There are some people that really have problems with the act of pushing that inhaler down
and sucking
it at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
They push and then they suck in air and that stuff all over the place. It's like probably 90% of medicine is out in the air. Mm-hmm. Everybody else's lungs are fine by the time they get done. So we went into that issue. So that tube helps actually keep the medicine in the tube. So you don't have to worry as much about when you take that breath in, just to keep the timing on point.
So somebody can use a nebulizer at home also, because the reason I asked, when my daughter, for example, has had very acute attacks, she's gone to the emergency room and they've put her on a nebulizer. But I didn't realize it's something you can do on a regular basis.
Yeah, some people prefer it. Mm-hmm. They have the same efficacy, so there's not a big difference. I don't know if people just feel more relaxed getting the air blown into their face instead of doing it on their own. Mm-hmm. But it's, you know, they're interchangeable.
So do you do lessons? Do you teach your patients? You do lessons and practice?
Yes,
with the inhaler.
As Dr. Newby stated, some people just blow it out. They didn't know they were supposed to inhale. So we wasted 2 puffs of our very expensive medicine. So why
is it so expensive? Do we know?
I mean,
if so many people have it.
Even with the Walmart formulary and the Target formulary, I've never seen an asthma medicine up there.
This whole problem with the drug industry is trying to sometimes understand how that works, the dynamics of what makes one drug cost more than another is always hard to decipher. I've had drugs that we've been using for 20-plus years, and and they're still as expensive as they were when they were on the market. I'm like, I mean, how is this possible? This is a generic drug. It costs just as much as it did 20 years ago.
But that takes it back to that health disparity issue that we have here in this country. If someone can't afford their medication, then they're not going to go seek treatment.
That's really what it boils down to.
Yes.
One of the things I wanted to bring up, right quickly, is just so people understand the dynamic of asthma, what it really is. You talk about bronchospasm. The bronchial tubes is how this air is transmitted. So when you breathe in air, it goes in the bronchial tubes and then down to the far reaches of the lung tissue. With asthma, you're talking about the bronchial tubes, they get constricted when you try to blow out. So it's almost like when you breathe in and then you blow out, the bronchial tubes constrict.
So and that constricts it.
Yeah, so, okay. So you're trying to blow air out. The air is, can't get out. And that's what's really happening. So when you talk about these inhalers, that, you know, where they're actually trying to open up the airway so you can take that breath in. So when Dr. James made that comment about, you know, people getting calm when they're feeling that shortness of breath, and that, I don't know if you've ever felt short of breath before, but that you can get panic mode real quick when you can't breathe. Slowing that breathing down does help to allow the air to expand, because you think about it, when you get excited, you're going to breathe faster, and if the air can't get out now and you start breathing even faster, that's going to create more of a problem if you try to expel that air. But once you calm that down, then all of a sudden you're the air can get out. Mm-hmm. It's, you're still going to be short of breath, but it won't be quite as severe.
Okay. Heather joins us from Norfolk. Hi, Heather. You're on the air.
Yes. I was calling. My son at age 2 fell asleep, I thought, on my lap at a doubleheader at Harbor Park baseball. It was very hot out. The sun went down. It got cold. His lips turned blue. I thought he was chilly. Thank goodness I pulled his T-shirt up. I saw his chest was completely concave. We rushed him to CHKD. He was not moving any air. Had we been in Chesapeake, he would have died. It was his first major asthma attack. I did not even know what asthma was. It turns out his is temperature, change in temperature induced. It could have been fatal. Home health brought a nebulizer to us after he was stabilized in the ER. And whenever we traveled where temperatures went from hot to cold, we had that nebulizer, and he could be treated. As he grew, he also had some exercise induced. His was not from coal dust. His was not from allergens. He lives in L.A. now. He's on a preventative inhaler in the morning and afternoon. Just if he gets a little wheezing, he's 24 years old. It was terrifying. It is fatal. I'm talking about the seriousness of this in our children, and I'm so happy you are addressing this. This is a major health issue.
Okay.
And I'm so sorry that African American women are dying from this.
Yeah.
I really think we need to get our health care providers to limit the cost of these prohibitively high medicines. They should be almost free of charge, if you ask me. But thank you very much.
You're very welcome. Before you go, let me ask you a quick question. Does anyone else in your family have asthma?
No. I never even heard of it. I didn't even know what it was.
Wow.
It was totally new to me. It was terrifying. I've learned a lot since. I go online, and I, like the doctor described, you go online, you look at what's happening to your lungs. It's terrifying for these children.
Okay. Thank you so much for your call. Dr. James, you want to react?
Yeah, that's a very scary event, but it's good that you were able to get them to get some help right away. Mm-hmm. And like you said, we're working on trying to get people to be aware of asthma so we can all be a part of helping get the prices mm-hmm. reduced.
Mm-hmm. So what other things could trigger an asthma attack? I know she said temperature and exercise was one for her son, but it's different in each individual?
It's different in everyone. And kind of how you were saying, is there a genetic component? Sometimes it does run in families, just as allergies can run in families sometimes. Mm-hmm. But sometimes people in families can have asthma for different reasons, because my younger sister has asthma and hers is more exercise induced and based on, you know, she's had it since a child. Now, it was an adult onset.
Mm-hmm.
But I think her son is doing the best thing by keeping it well controlled. And other things they've been seeing in weight, actually being overweight, can
trigger it also.
Mm-hmm, and smoking history or secondhand smoke exposure and job hazards. I don't know in detail what type of jobs. So we do have a lot of shipyard workers. I don't know if, you mm-hmm. know, specifically what things are getting in the lungs there. But mm-hmm. those are some other precipitating factors.
And sleep apnea, mm-hmm. too. I get a lot of, we have a ton of patients with sleep apnea that I determine because they have atypical type chest pain. And we run into a lot of that. And, you know, that's a big issue that we run into in terms of potential of creating breathing issues down the road, pulmonary hypertension and other types of lung disorders. So that's another factor. We have a ton of sleep apnea patients.
Wow. If you're just joining us, we're talking about asthma with family medical specialist Dr. Lauren James and my co-host, cardiologist Dr. Keith Newby. 440-2665 or 1-800-940-2240 are the numbers to call. Are there some things happening within your home that you want to ask the doctors about? Could they be possible triggers for asthma? 440-2665 or 1-800-940-2240. So, can asthma be cured?
There's no cure for asthma, but it can be controlled.
Okay.
So I agree.
Yeah.
But no cure. So
you can have a normal lifestyle, healthy, active, as long as you're taking your medicines.
I think some of the other points would be is whether or not you could call it a cure or not. I think some of it's going to be whether the trigger point is. Say, as an example, say if it's a certain allergen in this particular area that's specific to this area that somebody's exposed to, and that's their trigger point, they may move to another district that, you know, they're not exposed to it, and all of a sudden their asthma goes away. Now, they have the potential, if they get re-exposed back to that same, whatever that trigger point was, they could develop it again. But so I won't say it's a cure, but you can really temper it if you're not exposed to the same, whatever that trigger point
is. And if you know what
be.
That trigger point
exactly.
is.
Exactly.
Absolutely. 440-2665 or 1-800-940-2240. Queen joins us from Newport News. Hi, Queen. You're on the air.
Thanks. I had a question. I don't do any drugs, believe in drugs, for anything. And I've learned that there's a spa over in Williamsburg. It's the Williamsburg Salt Spa. They use Himalayan pink salt that they send through the air as a fine mist. And asthma is one of the things that they're claiming that they can help you with. It helps to reduce the inflammation. And I was wondering if the doctors had heard about that treatment and what they thought of it.
Okay, let me ask the doctors. Thanks so much for your call. Dr. James?
No, unfortunately, I have not heard of that treatment. But I would wonder, what would you do in an acute asthma attack if you were
Are you still
on this
with
type
us,
of
Queen?
Treatment?
We can barely hear you. Are you on your... can you turn your phone down?
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. It's Himalayan pink salt, which has 84 minerals in it. I don't know what you would do in that type of situation, but it is a treatment that you would come on a regular basis, maybe once a week, and you sit in this room for 45 minutes, $25, and it helps to reduce the inflammation is what I'm told. I've gone there for my sinuses, and it helped me tremendously.
Okay, thank you so much for the call, Queen. Dr. Newby?
Yeah, the only thing I would just say to Queen to just be careful about the feeling about not wanting to take any medicines at all for anything. I mean, I think I understand some of the thought processes, you know, and a lot of people have come to this conclusion that, you know, medicines are a bad thing because they're produced. You know, but every drug typically came from some type of plant, you know, or some natural kind of mechanism or I should say remedy that got transmitted into a pill form. You know, I think a lot of it's doing the research and understanding what the medicines are you're taking. But, you know, it's just like, you know, if somebody would tell me they read up on a drug and they see the side effects and they say, oh, this is just bad. I'm like, well, understand, those are potential side effects. That doesn't mean that you're going to have any of those. The majority of people I put on medicines, I guarantee if I put 100 people on medicine, I may get a call from five or six people about, you know, some issue. Yeah, but when I look about the number of people we've saved, you know, by putting them on certain types of medications and the data, you know, and I'm a big data person, I guess, because I came out of Duke, so that was all we were about was research down there. Mm-hmm. So when you kind of look at, you know, research and you do your investigation, you know, and I always encourage people to do that, but then ask your doc, because a lot of people who aren't medically trained to try to look at research studies and understand what they really mean. You know, you have to understand the meaning of it to really make the determination. And a lot of it, that's what we've been trained to do, is to look at that and how to look at it with a scientific eye and to say, okay, this is a good situation or a bad situation. Mm-hmm. So I really want to encourage her. And again, however people want to lead their lives, I don't try to convince them otherwise. But I always tell people, be careful, because sometimes those medicines can save you. And I have seen it many a times, you know, we have people with heart attacks before we start doing intervention. We had all the things we had were these drugs that bust up clots, you know, mm-hmm. and then you got a clot in your heart and, you know, I mean, you have no other alternative but to die or take or this take medicine. And I'm going to tell you, it saved many a life, you know. So I would just caution her to be careful to make it as a global, you know, I don't want to take anything at all or any time for anything. Mm-hmm. You know, you could do that. I mean, again, don't misunderstand the comment. It's just I always tell people to be a little cautious with that.
About that. 440-2665 or 1-800-940-2240. Garland joins us from Norfolk. Hi, Garland.
Okay, growing out of asthma?
Yeah, because I had it when I was a kid, and as I grew up, I got older, I'm in my 40s now. It's less severe now. Necessarily
still
need to take medication all the time, just
on occasion. Okay. James, you want to take that one? You want me to take that one?
You can.
Okay. what I would say to that is I don't know. I mean, I know that term is used, grow out of it. I'm not sure if it's so much that you do that versus, say, if it was an allergen that you were exposed to that was a trigger point for you. And, you know, as you get a little older, you know, it's like anything else, things change. You know, your body gets adapted to that allergen, and it doesn't affect you like it did when you were younger. I think you find there's more adaptation than it is anything else mm-hmm. as the things, you know, as you change. I mean, it's like with a certain heart rhythm disturbances, we'll see that they occur more in people in their mid-20s to mid-30s for certain types of heart rhythm disturbances. And that it's not so much that it's because they grew into it, but their body changed. As a body changed, then all of a sudden these new occurrences can happen. So I think it's more in that situation that you probably, whatever was triggering it, your body probably adapted to it and may not be as much of a trigger point for you anymore.
Dr. James, are there pills that you can take? Is there anything, or is everything oral to treat?
Everything is pretty, well, the inhalers are all nebulizer sprays, mm-hmm. But like we were saying, as an adjunct therapy, you can do an antihistamine, mm-hmm. which is like a Zyrtec or a Claritin.
But that's an over-counter. I mean, yeah, would you also prescribe some sort of pill or?
Well, in people who are very severely asthmatic, and mm-hmm. usually they see a pulmonologist specialist. And another thing I forgot to say that triggers asthma attacks are viruses. If you have a really bad cold or bronchitis, and oftentimes they'll have to be on steroids to help them get over it. But I don't know of a another pill.
There was mm-hmm. you know, I'm a little older than Dr. James, so just a little bit. But when I was coming through back in the 1990s in medicine, there was some pill forms of bronchodilators, albuterol and what have you. But I don't think they use them much anymore. Because they're hard to control. You know, mm-hmm. when you think about it, because you know the problem with some of the bronchodilators. Talk about a beta agonist, which is some of those are. They beta agonists speed the heart up. So a lot of people would get, you know, that feeling, the heart racing, you know, mm-hmm. when they use these inhalers. You know, see, the thing is with
inhalers. And that's going to be even worse, though, yeah. isn't it? Because you're already in a kind of freaked out mode because.
Yeah. Well, it can be. And some people mm-hmm. say that's why they don't want to take them, because they feel that sensation. The pill form of that, again, used to be available, but I don't know if it is anymore. But I know at the time, the problem is you can't control that. Inhalers, you know, they're going to, you take it, it makes the heart race for a bit, then it starts to calm down pretty quickly after that. Pill form, you're stuck with it till the pill wears off. So mm-hmm. I think that's partly maybe why. And plus, my assumption is because there are some inhalers that can trigger heart rhythm, dangerous heart rhythm disturbances. And that's why we've seen sudden death in people, not often. So mm-hmm. when people get scared to use an inhaler, I get in trouble on the show. But I think if you kind of see sometimes.
I think Dr. James would take issue with that too.
but you do, every now and then you'll see some of those, you know, there was some data that came out a few years ago saying those inhalers were killing people. Because of some of those triggered arrhythmias, but that's not something you see very often out of the number of people use with inhalers. So, I mean, that's, you know, like a million to one.
Okay, 440-2665 or 1-800-940-2240. Devin joins us from Hampton. Hi, Devin, you're on the air.
Yes, ma'am. My name is Dennis.
Dennis? I apologize.
That's all right. my question is, I have sleep apnea.
Mm-hmm.
And every once in a while, I'll take a couple of drops of eucalyptus oil and put it on my CPAP filter and inhale the eucalyptus vapors. Is this harmful?
I would think not.
Yeah. Spas and things like that, it probably just relaxes you. Some people think lavender and things like that also relax you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I would think the answer no, it wouldn't hurt you at all. I've never heard any data to suggest otherwise.
Okay, that's good. 440-2665 or 1-800-940-2240. Mary joins us from Gloucester. Hi, Mary. You're on the air.
Thank you for taking my call. Yes. I know old white women from the country aren't your usual call-in people.
Oh, but we love everybody calling in, Mary.
Admire you and your program.
Thank you so much, and we appreciate you.
Well, thank you so much. Concerning asthma.
Yes, ma'am.
I had my first attack at my fourth birthday party. It was triggered by a cake baked in the shape of a lamb with lots of white sugary icing and coconut on it. Mm. My father said by the time the guests were leaving, you could hear me as far as you could see me. That was 1939. Now, been through it. One of my sons has had a very strong asthma and managed to get 7 athletic letters. So, obviously, we know something about management.
Mm-hmm.
100 units of vitamin C a day, no cold drinks, no sugar.
Mm-hmm. And did you learn that kind of over time because
the doctor who refused to do surgery on my son, the same sinus surgery that had helped me, but getting rid of the sugar, the cold drinks.
Okay. All right. Let's.
When my son went and increasing the moisture in the air. Humidifiers are crucial. Mm-hmm. My son went to bed with an orange section, half an orange open on his windowsill. When he started having trouble breathing, he pulled out an orange section and ate it. When he came off the wrestling mat, I gave him a cup of hot coffee.
Hmm. Okay, let me get the doctors to respond to this, Mary. Thank you so much for listening and for calling in. We do appreciate you. Yeah. Definitely. Dr. James?
And very, very good to hear that her son was able to be athletic and, mm-hmm. you know, achieve his goals. And I think, like she said, some of her recommendations sound valid. And I think it goes back to triggers. Maybe those were associated with what type of things triggered his asthma attacks. And I think another thing, you know, she kind of reflected on is just people knowing the level of what type of asthma they have. If anybody's ever been intubated or ever been on oral steroids for an asthma attack, you are very high risk. So when you have these symptoms, you have to get care immediately. And I think that's another thing that people fail to realize.
So there are levels of asthma?
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. Can you elaborate a little bit more on that?
So it's mild, moderate, and then severe. I think I'm leaving one out in the middle, but that's mm-hmm. the gist mm-hmm. of it. And so a severe asthmatic is anybody who's ever had to be on breathing machines such as intubation or steroids.
Wow. 440-2665 or 1-800-940-2240. We're talking about asthma with Dr. Lauren James and Dr. Keith Newby. Michael joins us from Hopewell. Hi, Michael. You're on the air.
Hello. I just had a question about asthma and allergic reactions in general as it relates to how do we go about programming the body not to go berserk and attack things that are not a threat. I remember hearing the information at one point suggesting that eating the allergen can sometimes reset the body's reaction to it. There was a piece on poison ivy, which causes an allergic reaction in most people, and presenter suggested that if they could ever find a way to make the stuff palatable enough to eat, that would reset the allergic reaction and people would no longer get a rash in response to it. Is there any reliable way to get the body to respond to something that is not a threat to quell an allergic reaction like this?
Let's get a response from the doctors. Thanks so much for your call, Michael.
Yeah, I'll let you have that one.
Okay. I have not personally read about that, but I get the theory you're kind of referring to is that our immune system basically has to figure out a way to, you know, overcome it. And then, you know, basically the asthma process is kind of like your body is attacking, you know, the allergen and causing this inflammation. And if I knew... If I knew the answer to your question, I would be very rich. But unfortunately, I am not well versed in that. And I would actually think just seeing how severe people can have allergies to peanut butter.
It might be kind of dangerous to do that.
Well, I think that's kind of the theory of the, you know, the allergy physicians that, you know, that once they determine what your allergies are, you know, you go in and get those monthly injections because essentially they're exposing you to a degree to that allergen to try to train your body to not react. Whether or not that actually works, you know, I think I've come to this conclusion that medicine is, you know, why they call it the practice of medicine is because there's nothing that's set in stone. There's nothing to me that I think, you know, I can treat heart failure in five different people five different ways and I get five different reactions, you know, from those patients. You know, there's nothing set in stone with how things go. Everybody's an individual. And that's the one thing that I try to emphasize to patients all the time is, you know, although the data says like this works, but it doesn't work in everybody.
Well, you know, and that brings you back to the point, because I know that when you have an allergy, they do have to give you all those shots to try to figure out what it is you're allergic to. How do you figure out what your trigger is? I mean, can it be multiple
triggers?
Well, they
do the test. You know, they do those skin tests.
Oh, so they do that the same.
Yeah, they do
the
skin. What happens is they do the skin test to determine what you're allergic to. Then they give you this big panel of, you know, what the things are. And then they
But that can be used for asthma also.
Yeah, I mean, because if it's, well, they can in the sense of if the allergen is actually triggering the asthma, then they try to train your body not to react. You know, now the question is, does it work? I mean, and some people, they've told me they've gotten a significant benefit from allergy injections. I have other people say they haven't had as much benefit.
Okay. Ann joins us from the Eastern Shore. Hi, Ann. You're on the air. Hello, Ann. Are you there? Okay. I think we lost Ann. Let's see. Let's go to Dave in Gloucester. Hi, Dave. You're on the air.
Hello.
Hi. You're on the air.
Hey, good. This is Mark from Norfolk. Look, I just wanted to, my son has asthma, and so he has his bouts with it. But one of the things I just wanted to add in was that I had a conversation with my son's pulmonary specialist. And what I discovered from talking to him was he was actually saying that the pharmaceutical companies actually understand that there are so many variations of treatment for asthma specifically, and they know that for sure, but if they try to come out with medications to treat all these different variations, it would basically almost deteriorate their profit margins because they wouldn't have a particular drug that would have such a demand to where it would be worth them producing to be able to make the money. So just wanted to add that in. They are aware that there are other medications that can treat from acute to minor asthma, but those drugs haven't surfaced on the market strictly, I guess, based on capitalistic reasons.
Interesting theory, huh?
Mark, thank you
for that call.
I've never been in a board meeting of a pharmaceutical company, but I would love to be a fly on the wall just to hear those conversations.
So what is Dr. Lauren, Dr. James,
no problem.
What would be your key advice to people, particularly those who have never had an asthma attack? What should they be looking out for? What should they try to stay away from? How should they try to deal with that?
Even though you might not have asthma yourself, still just educating yourself on common signs and symptoms, like we talked about, cough, chest tightness, wheezing, and kind of talking to family members or friends that may have asthma to improve your awareness, and still watching out for allergens or things that may aggravate these symptoms in yourself if you have it, or in others you may know.
Okay. So. Let's see. Ann is back from the Eastern Shore. Let's see if we can get her this time. Hi, Ann. You're on the air.
Hi.
Hi. You're on the air. May I have your question?
Excuse me. I just swallowed incorrectly. I have a 35-year-old asthmatic daughter, and one of the things that they recommended to me very early on was to make sure that her sleeping environment was carpet-free, stuffed animal-free, and so we have limited wall-to-wall carpeting, and it's not the carpeting per se, it's the dust mite feces, which is, you know, people don't want to accept the fact that they exist, but They do. They exist in everything. And then the other, the third most important step I was recommended to do was to wrap her box spring and mattress. So in other words, when they say wrap, they're talking about using an allergy cover on both the box spring and the mattress. And I'll tell you, that made a world of difference in the life of my daughter.
Okay.
Sleeping environment is extremely important.
Thank you so much, Ann, for that call. So again, that's back to that environmental.
Right, right. And
trigger.
The carpeting probably just held, you know, a lot of dust and things like that in it. So maybe that was what they were thinking. I haven't exactly heard of the wrapping of the bed, but if you saw some benefits with it, definitely.
And that's the way to go. Yeah. Dr. Newby?
Yeah, I've run to that a couple of times. I've heard people say they're wrapping the bed. I think it's just the environment. Because you think, if you really look at it, if you go into a room, and the room's been closed off for a long period of time, and you go in there, you're going to see a bunch of dust everywhere.
And you see it in the air.
I mean, and it's just, I think, just that living environment does play a big factor. I think what they really instructed her to do is just take away all the possibilities, you know, and by saying, you know, get rid of the wall carpet, anything that's going to hold on to anything, you know, the wrapping of the bed. I think that's just eliminating all the possibilities without knowing specifically what she was reacting to. But they were able to just take away all the potentials.
So, Dr. Newby, I know you want to talk about smoking because you always talk about smoking. And since smoking is a major factor in terms of allergies also, you want to give folks another pep talk about quitting smoking?
Well, for my last show from last time. I think like anything else, you know, those exposures, if you look at, you know, I remember when I was growing up, they used to have the pictures of when you took a puff in, what it actually did to your lungs. You see all this black stuff all in there. And I've actually seen when in medical school when we used to work on cadavers that had been smoking, you would just see the black lung. I mean, literally it was black. And you know, when you see that, it does bring some reality to what we expose ourselves to and what we're doing to ourselves. But smoking, not only just with asthma, but just vascular, you know, disease, stroke risk, you know, heart attack risk, you know, the cancer risk. I mean, it's just such a high problem that, I mean, I say it's a high incident problem that we see. That, I mean, I can't even justify, you know, doing that. I mean, I understand the addiction. Trust me, I've talked to people who say they can give up crack cocaine and heroin before they can give up cigarettes. So the addiction is real. It's just how to get people to that stage of getting them to want to quit and to be able to quit is where our dilemma is. I mean, that's probably the strongest addiction I've ever seen in existence. So, and I understand that. So I know that's why people can't just... Some people can cold turkey quit. Most can't. Mm-hmm. I know it's because of that reason there, but it does play a factor with this, the breathing issues, the potential asthma, the vascular disease, cancer risk. I mean, it's so abundant.
Okay. We got about a minute left, okay. Dr. James. Secondhand smoke, a problem for asthma?
Yes, definitely. Okay. Especially in children who aren't themselves smoking. That is a major trigger. And, you know, being around cigarette smoke can cause ADHD, they think, and lead to a lot of other things. And eventually, if your child is impaired by asthma, they'll be not participating in school and missing days and not able to achieve.
And to that point, real quick, that secondhand smoke, a lot of people would go outside and smoke, and they come back in, they don't realize they're bringing all that right back in with them. I mean, you know, so they're thinking that, I mean, it's better to do that than to be smoking in
the house.
But
right.
I don't want people to think just because they do that, that it's taking away that potential, because you come right back in, it's all over you, and you can smell it down the hall.
Okay. Thank you, doctors, Dr. Lauren
Thank
James
you.
And
Thank
Dr.
You.
Keith Newby. We really appreciate it, and we will be right back.
Hello, I'm Reverend Al Sharpton, host of Politics Nation, and you're listening to Another View on WHRV 89.5 FM.
Wow, Dr. Al Sharpton, how about that? In spite of jokes and stereotypes to the contrary, going green has become a mainstream trend in the African-American community. In fact, right here in Hampton Roads, many folks have teamed up and are participating in the Great American Cleanup. Our Lisa Godley introduces us to some teenagers who have decided to do their part by picking up trash in downtown Portsmouth.
In an episode of the popular Candid web series, Black Folk Don't, a conversation emerged about whether or not African Americans take part in going green.
It certainly is not fly to be driving a Prius. Like, that is not going to be the popular car in the rap video.
Professional black folk go green. Folk in the hood ain't going so green and not interested in it.
Black people are very green because when it comes to leaving the lights on and stuff, most black people are worried about the utility bill. So they're like, turn those lights off.
While the popular web program is done with humor, it forces us to take a second look at the myths and stereotypes that so many accept as fact. The president of the Portsmouth chapter of Jack and Jill of America, LaTanya Gray, is quick to point out that black people do indeed go green. Her group dismisses this myth with their recent participation in the Great American Cleanup.
We care just as much about our environment as anyone else who lives in the city. So we have to live here too, so why would we not want to keep it nice and clean?
The Great American Cleanup is the largest grassroots community involvement program in the United States. This community initiative helps bring people together to build and sustain vibrant communities. During one of the Great American Cleanup events held in Portsmouth, Virginia, I asked Trinity Woodson and Jeffrey Jones, two teens with Jack and Jill of America, about their experience in helping clean up the city.
Today we're doing the Great American Cleanup and just picking up litter around the city of Portsmouth, mainly on the main streets. Because of how the city is for us and making ways for us to be able to do things and have different opportunities, I feel like this is the least I can do.
It felt like it was the right thing to do at the time. I was feeling good today. You know, I felt like I need to help out the community. It's just out of the kindness of my heart.
Gray spoke about why it's important to get the children involved with giving back to the community.
We try to teach our children to give back to the community, so this is part of our program, Civic Responsibility.
And Dana Woodson, a parent of one of the Jack and Jill teens, agreed.
We feel like with the youth participating and giving back and making sure that the environment is protected and available to them and their offspring later. That's a big deal to us to just, you know, of course, we can preach it all day long, but then when we actually see youth in action, that really sends the message.
And it does send a message. The youth of Jack and Jill dove right in, helping to clear the streets of Portsmouth for the Great American Cleanup. What the youth did for this city is something that all teens and people of the community can do no matter their demographic. Another Jack and Jill teen, Jordan Yowell, explained that sometimes teens find doing community service intimidating. But in actuality, you can start with what's right in front of your face.
Because a lot of teenagers are busy with a lot of other things. I don't think they open their eyes and look around at what's in front of them, and they really don't know where to start with community service, but really it's not that hard.
The Great American Cleanup has other community events planned to help clean up our environment. If you're interested in helping to clean the Hampton Roads community, please visit our website at anotherviewradio.org for more information on the Great American Cleanup, including upcoming events and going green tips. For Another View, I'm Lisa Godley.
And in full disclosure, Lisa is the teen advisor for the Portsmouth chapter of Jack and Jill of America. Our intern, Denise Norris, produced the story. If you'd like to know what green events are going on in your community, you can go to askhrgreen.org. And that's our show for today. I'm so glad you decided to join us. Next week, we're going to be talking about women and unemployment and how one group is doing its part to help women become self-sustaining. Producer Lisa Godley will be in the interview chair, so be sure to tune in. Our theme music was composed and performed by Jay Sennett. Lisa Godley is our producer. Victor Bowen is our audio engineer. And Shamira Cole answered our phones. I'm Barbara Ham Lee. Thanks for listening, and let's get together again next Friday at noon for Another View. Have a great weekend, everybody.